Okay, now some of you will be glad to know that this is the last lesson in this series titled The Bible and Homosexual Conduct, and I'm grateful for the opportunity to teach it, very much so. And I encourage you to share the lessons with young people who were not here. I wanted to have young people here, but other things are going on, so I encourage you to share the lessons. They are audio and video recordings of the lessons on the church website, so that might be helpful in that regard. And my notes, the complete set of notes, are available on my website, theoutlet.us. Okay? Now, in the first 4 weeks of this class, we saw that homosexual conduct is condemned without restriction in the Old Testament, and that Jews before, during, and after the first century, they uniformly understood that fact. Then we saw over the last few weeks of the class that homosexual conduct is condemned without restriction in the New Testament. And today I want to begin with looking at how the early church, the generations after the apostles, viewed the matter. Now, given the testimony of the Old Testament, given the uniform understanding of ancient Jews, given the testimony of the New Testament, one certainly would expect homosexual conduct to be clearly condemned in the post-New Testament writings of the early church, and that is precisely what one finds. See, which confirms and reinforces that we're reading Scripture correctly in understanding it to condemn all homosexual conduct. That's the function of church history. People say, I don't care about that. But it is, Scripture is the authority, but church history functions to inform our interpretation. So if you have an interpretation that's exotic, that no one has ever held before, well, that's an alarm bell for you. Okay, so it is something, if you see and you say, okay, this looks clear to me, and then you see that confirmed in how Jews uniformly understood it and how the early church uniformly understood it, you say, okay, well, I'm right in the stream. I'm seeing that correctly. Bernadette Bruton is a scholar I've mentioned to you before. She's an avowed lesbian, self-avowed lesbian. And she wrote an influential book titled Love Between Women, Early Christian Responses to Female Homoeroticism, published in 1996 by the University of Chicago Press. Now, Bruton says in that book, Boswell argued, now that's John Boswell, who was a pro-homosexual scholar some decades ago. Boswell argued that, quote, the early Christian church does not appear to have opposed homosexual behavior per se, end quote. So she's referring to Boswell. Boswell said, no, the church really didn't do it. It only opposed homosexual behavior in certain specific circumstances, in certain contexts, whether exploitative, coercive, whether idol worship, those kinds of things. But not homosexual behavior per se. All right, Bruton says, Boswell argued that the early Christian church does not appear to have opposed homosexual behavior per se. The sources on female homoeroticism that I present in this book run absolutely counter to that conclusion. So she says his stuff is not factual. It's not factual. When I go and I get the sources and pull them up, they disprove that claim. The Oxford Dictionary of the Christian Church. In the New Testament, homosexual behavior is mentioned and condemned in 1 Corinthians 6, 9 to 11, 1 Timothy 1, 10, and most influentially in Romans 1, 27, which many moralists have seen as supporting the view that homosexuality is, with other sexual acts which are not procreative, contrary to natural law. Patristic, early church, medieval, and later Christian moralists have not questioned this judgment. And it is only in recent times that some writers have argued that the quality of a relationship, be it homosexual or heterosexual, is what determines its moral value. Only in recent times Now, Marion Swords is a New Testament scholar, and Swords writes in his book, The Bible and Homosexuality, Swords, or Scripture and Homosexuality. Swords says, as we saw above, this is in his book, in the earliest period of Christian writing, that would be the apostolic period, Paul expressed the traditional Jewish rejection of homosexual behavior in the new context of the Christian community. Paul's remarks about homosexual behavior were made in such a way that he simply assumed other Christians would have agreed with him that homosexual acts were not permissible among members of the church. Paul made no attempt to defend or to respond to criticism of his position on homosexuality. Thus, from the limited instances in which earliest Christianity treats homosexuality, we see plainly that homosexual behavior was rejected, that it was considered contrary to the will of God for human life. The evidence from the time following the decades in which the New Testament was composed, the post-New Testament era, yields an equally negative assessment of homosexuality. A range of authors, including Justin Martyr, Tertullian, Basil of Caesarea, Gregory of Nyssa, the participants in the councils in Elvira and Ancyra, the authors of the apostolic constitutions, John Chrysostom and Augustine, and others, I might add, all expressed sharp disapproval of homosexual behavior. Now, David Wright, who before his death in 2008 was a renowned expert on the early church, he writes in the Encyclopedia of Early Christianity, the church fathers universally condemned male homosexual behavior, although the Levitical prohibition was not frequently cited, Clement of Alexandria, Tertullian, Origen, and Eusebius being exceptions, meaning they were people who did cite the Levitical prohibitions. He said, no evidence suggests it, the Levitical prohibition, was felt to be no longer binding or to condemn only ceremonial uncleanness. Stoic influence reinforced Paul's portrayal of homosexuality as unnatural, and early Christian writers regularly characterized it in these terms. They clearly regarded it as contrary to the created constitution and function of men and women, and not merely to the dispositions of particular individuals. It is a creation issue. All the evidence indicates that the teaching mind of the early church unreservedly condemned homosexual activity. So, we look at the Old Testament. We look at the Jewish understanding of the Old Testament, we look at the New Testament, and we look at the early church. All speak with one uniform voice that homosexual conduct is sinful, without exception. Now that's important, that's powerful. You see, that's powerful, that's what the Scripture's talking about. Now some supporters of homosexual unions, they claim that the interpretation of Scripture as approving slavery. The interpretation of Scripture as approving slavery was revised only in the last few centuries when the destructive consequences of slavery became so apparent that slavery was exposed as being incompatible with broader themes of Scripture. You see, the church's understanding of those texts, the idea that the church interpreted the Bible to mean that God approved of slavery, the claim is that the church's understanding and interpretation of those texts was reworked. You see, it was reworked in light of the painful experience of slavery that was in part brought about by that traditional understanding, what they allege is the traditional understanding. And so then that was brought up, caused a reworking, kind of. Our eyes were jarred open, and we realized, wow, this slavery is really inconsistent with broader themes of Scripture. That then caused us to go back and say, well, you know, Scripture really doesn't approve of that. But we were blind to that all the way until the colonial era. Okay, the argument is an analogy. They say, look, this is what is happening and what must happen in the texts that condemn homosexual conduct. And the analogy looks like this. Okay, Scripture was incorrectly interpreted to mean God approves of slavery. That incorrect interpretation was abandoned when slavery was exposed in the last few centuries, in the colonial era, as being incompatible with broader themes of Scripture. In the same way, you see, this is the argument. In the same way, Scripture was incorrectly interpreted to mean God disapproves of homosexual conduct. That incorrect interpretation must now be abandoned since that disapproval of homosexual conduct has been exposed in the modern era as being incompatible with broader themes of Scripture. Okay, there's much that's wrong with this, and let me just walk you through it. There's much that's wrong with this. First, to interpret Scripture to mean that God approves of slavery clearly is incorrect, but it is not incorrect to interpret Scripture to mean God disapproves of homosexual conduct. So the parallel breaks down immediately. The parallel breaks down immediately. Well, why do I say that to interpret Scripture to mean God approves of slavery clearly is incorrect? Slavery was a post-fall human institution. It was not something ordained by God, not something instituted by God, and nothing in Scripture declares it as a moral good. It's not like marriage, which God instituted. It is a post-fall human institution. Scripture reveals that God tolerated. He tolerated within ancient Israel and the church a regulated form of old world slavery. He tolerated a regulated form of old world slavery. You say, well, isn't to tolerate something doesn't mean that you're blessing it and approving of it? Well, no. We know that God sometimes tolerates things that are not his ideal, such as divorce. Doesn't Jesus say that that's not how it was? But because as a concession to the hardness of men's hearts, that God tolerated divorce, perhaps the ancient world was so warped, so sinful, and that slavery had become so inextricably bound up and embedded in that world that mandating the immediate opposition and termination of slavery would have done much more harm in terms of economic suffering, in terms of anarchy, that it would have done more harm in that particular historical context than planting seeds for slavery's gradual eradication. You see, who can make that call? You see, only God knows all the relevant factors and all of the consequences of all of the possible approaches. Who are we to say that God has to say, no, go to war now over slavery? That's the way to do it. Who's to say that God cannot see that in that context of a warped and dark world where slavery is so embedded, that to do that would create more suffering than to go about eradicating it by planting the seeds of its destruction and allow the world to be softened and transformed by the influence of Christianity? Who's to make that call? Okay, who's to make that call? So, no, it's not to tolerate something doesn't mean that you approve of it. God can have reasons for doing that. And note that what was tolerated was a regulated form of old world slavery. Not the slavery we think of, not New World slavery, not colonial slavery that we think of. And there was a significant difference. That doesn't mean that Old World slavery was moral, that Old World slavery was good. It does mean that it is different. So when you're looking at him tolerating a regulated form of Old World slavery, you can't think in terms of New World slavery. S. Scott Barchi, he explains this. He's a specialist on this topic. And he writes in the Anchor Bible Dictionary, comparing old world to new world slavery. Old world slavery, racial factors played no role. Education was greatly encouraged. Some slaves were better educated than their owners and enhanced the slave's value. Many slaves carried out sensitive and highly responsible social functions. And then I bring in from elsewhere in the article, for example, doctors, teachers, writers, accountants, agents, bailiffs, overseers, secretaries, and sea captains. They weren't all doing menial labor out picking cotton or working in the house. It was a different institution. Slaves could own property, including other slaves. Their religious and cultural traditions were the same as those of the freeborn. No laws prohibited public assembly of slaves. And perhaps above all, the majority of urban and domestic slaves could legitimately anticipate being emancipated by the age of 30. So I just want you to see, when you think about this, God regulated or tolerated, he tolerated a regulated form of old world slavery. And the regulations that God imposed on that old world slavery made even that institution more humane. Okay, now I'll talk about this some more, Lord willing, in the upcoming class on answering the new atheism, because this is one of the arguments that the new atheists make. God is immoral. And one of the things they make in that argument is, look, he's all pro-slavery, and we all know slavery's no good. Okay, so I'll go into some more details about the text and those kinds of things there. I didn't want to do that here. But I want you to see the idea and the concept that God did not affirmatively approve of slavery is evident from the fact that Scripture itself points the way to the ultimate eradication of slavery. Scripture itself points the way. But there are no biblical signposts, nothing the least bit comparable, pointing to the eradication of the absolute creation-based ban on homosexual conduct, the seeds of the dissolution of all slavery. Those seeds were sown in Old Testament texts. Like Exodus 21:6, whoever steals a man and sells him, and anyone found in possession of him shall be put to death. There will be no abducting of people into slavery. Death penalty. Leviticus 25:39, if your brother, speaking of a fellow Jew, sells himself to you, you shall not make him serve as a slave. Do you see the sense? Do you see that this isn't something that is wonderful? Philemon 16, receive him, this runaway slave, no longer as a slave, but better than a slave. How are you to receive him? As a dear brother. Ooh, as a dear brother. Ephesians 6, 9, masters, do not threaten your slaves. Colossians 4, 1, masters, skip the hyphen, provide your slaves what is right and fair. 1 Timothy 6, 1 and 2, masters are brothers. They are brothers. You see, and you note also that Jesus' teaching about mercy and forgiving debts in Matthew chapter 6 and Matthew 18, that implies the inappropriateness of debt slavery. So all of these signposts and these pointers, and as many people have said, were these seeds of equality, these seeds of brotherhood, where those seeds came to full flower, the very institution of slavery would no longer be slavery, and that is indeed just what happened. When the implications of these texts came to full flower, the institution of slavery was done away with. Nothing of what God tolerated in that historical context, in the historical context of ancient Israel and the early church, nothing needs to be, quote, reworked in the sense of interpreted contrary to the intention of the inspired writer in order for other forms of slavery, such as slavery in the colonial era, or slavery in other contexts. Nothing has to be reworked for other forms of slavery or slavery in other contexts to be acknowledged and attacked as an intolerable evil. You don't have to twist anything. You don't have to take anything contrary to the intention of the inspired writers. Again, God didn't create the institution of slavery. He didn't ordain it. He didn't bless it and say, yes, this is something that is a moral good. He didn't pronounce it as a moral good. He didn't do that. He simply tolerated a regulated form of it in a specific historical situation. But as I've shown, I hope you agree with that. As I've shown over the last 8 weeks, denying the intention of the inspired writers is precisely what must be done to claim that Scripture is compatible with any form of homosexual conduct. You have to deny the intention of the inspired writers today to say that. The proscription of homosexual conduct is absolute. Is not tied to any particular social context, but rather it's based on the creation of mankind as male and female. It's as fundamental as that. Based on the creation of mankind as male and female, and God's intention that they join together in an exclusive one flesh union of marriage. The only alternative to sexual activity within a heterosexual marriage is celibacy. Jesus indicates that in Matthew 19. And I've talked about that. So in the first case, the first situation you see, the parallel immediately breaks down. All right, to say Scripture was incorrectly interpreted to mean God, well, that's certainly incorrect to say that. But it is not incorrect to say that Scripture means God disapproves of homosexual conduct. So the parallel breaks down immediately. And secondly, the claim that Christians, until the colonial era, held the incorrect interpretation of Scripture to mean that God approves of slavery. Here they were, scriptural tradition, church tradition. They thought that God approved of slavery all these years, and we get to the colonial era when we see slavery, and they're, let me go back now and think. Oh, I see that I was wrong for all those centuries. That's not true. That is not true. That's not how it happened. Early Christians understood that Scripture itself points the way to the ultimate eradication of slavery. They not only demonstrated a radically different attitude toward slaves, dealing with them as they did free men. That's how the early Christians dealt with them, as they did free men. But they began the practice of freeing slaves one by one as they had opportunity. Where do you think they're getting that from? Oh, no. They thought God sanctified slavery, that it was a moral good. No, they didn't. They recognized the seeds of these things. There are reports of early Christians releasing huge numbers of slaves, regarding which the church historian Philip Schaff, he says, these legendary traditions may indeed be doubted as to the exact facts of the case, and probably are greatly exaggerated, but they are nevertheless conclusive as exponents of the spirit which animated the church at that time concerning the duty of Christian masters. It was felt that in a thoroughly Christianized society, there can be no room for despotism on the one hand and slavery on the other. So the early church, what are they doing? They're releasing slaves. Why? Because they recognize the implications of brotherhood. They recognize the implications of those texts, that what that meant. Paul Chamberlain, who's a Canadian philosopher, he says in AD 315, only 2 years after the Edict of Milan, the Christian Emperor Constantine took the small step of criminalizing the act of stealing children for the purpose of bringing them up as slaves. Why do you think he did that? You see, what influence do you see at work in this ancient world that now the Roman emperor is criminalizing this. He says, over the next few centuries, Christian bishops and councils called for the redemption and freeing of slaves, and Christian monks freed many themselves. The effects were stunning. By the 12th century, slaves in Europe were rare, and by the 14th century, they were almost unknown on that continent, including in England. Including in England. Okay, so what has happened? What is the influence that is doing this? What is the leaven that is spreading, that is eliminating slavery in this dark world? It was Christianity. It was Christianity. Now, European slavery was revived. The Empire Strikes Back. European slavery was revived some 300 years later by the British. Was revived in the 17th century, driven by economic considerations. The British were followed in that by the Spanish and the Portuguese. But we have a 300-year period, roughly, where there's essentially no slavery in Europe. And then we wind up having it being revived by the British. And then what happens after that? The abolitionist movement. The abolitionist movement of the late 18th and 19th centuries, led by whom? Led by Christians. Led by believers in Jesus Christ. Led by people who believe the Bible is the Word of God. That's who the abolitionists were. The abolitionists were those kinds of people, people like William Wilberforce, Charles Spurgeon, John Wesley, William Lloyd Garrison, Charles Finney, Harriet Beecher Stowe. They saw that this was contrary to Scripture. Now, of course, there were people in the colonial era who said, no, no, the Bible supports this. But that's not the traditional view. And it was the abolitionists who appealed to Scripture to trump them. So people say, no, I can find you people argue. Yeah, I know people argue the Bible, argue all kinds of stuff. Just like people use the Bible to argue that homosexual conduct's okay. But that doesn't mean it is. And that's certainly not the traditional view of the church, as though the church bopped along under this misinterpretation for century and century, only when the colonial era, oh, what do you know? I now see that slavery is, you know, this, okay, this is really bad. Let me go back and revisit this. Okay, that's not what happened. They were motivated. These abolitionists understood the implications of those biblical texts that I cited to you. And they also were motivated by the texts that forbid, that outright condemn kidnapping and slave trading. The Exodus 21:16 and 1 Timothy 1:10. Activities that characterized colonial slavery. So they not only saw the implications of equality and brotherhood that are in these texts, they also saw the express condemnations of snatching somebody and throwing them into slavery. The abolitionists were believers. All right, finally, on this whole idea, this analogy that's being presented, I've already indicated the broader themes of Scripture. You see, there are no broader themes of Scripture that support the claim that homosexual conduct is acceptable to God. From Genesis on, the Bible is a thoroughly heterosexual book. Thoroughly heterosexual book. Here's Robert Gagnon. Here's how he summarized it. I read this slide to you some weeks ago. Indeed, every narrative, law, proverb, exhortation, poetry, and metaphor in the pages of Scripture that has anything to do with sexual relations presupposes a male-female prerequisite for sexual relations and marriage. Well, let me say in conclusion, not just of today, but of the whole study. I hear you saying amen. I hear that. Let me say in conclusion, homosexual conduct is condemned expressly and repeatedly in both the Old and New Testaments. And this has been recognized unanimously by Jews and Christians for millennia. It's only in the last 60 years or so. Do you realize that? 60 years? So for millennia, everyone understood And now in the last 60 years, only then do we have homosexuals, homosexuals and their allies, do they claim to have perceived a truth that eluded all others through the ages? Only in the last 60 years or so. What do you know? All of these people, all of these Jews, all of these Christians, all of these theologians, all of these scholars, they just didn't get it. And only now do we actually see something. Trying one argument after another, throw one thing against the wall after another, they grope for a way to justify the unjustifiable, imposing on Scripture their own desire. Let me read to you a review by a fellow named Christopher Yuan. Now, Christopher Yuan is a believer in Jesus Christ who experiences same-sex attraction. He's a believer in Jesus who experiences same-sex attraction. He's reviewing a book by Matthew Vines that I've mentioned before. This was Vines' book that was published last year called God and the Gay Christian. His book, Vines' book, repeats discredited arguments and yet another attempt to deny what the Bible says about homosexual conduct. Vines' book is no, God's really, he's fine with it. All right, here's Christopher Yuan, a Christian with same-sex attraction, reviewing Vines' book. It appears to me that Vines starts with the conclusion that God blesses same-sex relationships and then moves backwards to find evidence. This is not exegesis. See, exegesis is drawing out of the text the meaning. You draw out what the author intended. He says this is not exegesis, but a classic example of eisegesis, reading our own biases into the text. Like Vines, I also came out as a gay man while I was a student. I was a graduate student pursuing a doctorate in dentistry. Unlike Vines, I was not raised in a Christian home. Interestingly, a chaplain gave me a book from a gay-affirming author, John Boswell, I mentioned a moment ago, claiming that homosexuality is not a sin. Like Vines, I was looking for biblical justification and wanted to prove that the Bible blesses gay relationships. As I read Boswell's book, the Bible was open next to it, and his assertions did not line up with Scripture. Eventually, I realized that I was wrong, that same-sex romantic relationships are a sin. My years of biblical language study in Bible college and seminary and doctoral research in sexuality only strengthened this conclusion. No matter how hard I tried to find biblical justification, and no matter whether my same-sex temptations went away or not, God's word did not change. Years later, I found out that the gay-affirming chaplain also recognized his error. Now, you see, I look at something like this and I just say, amen. You see, somebody who can sit here and say, I'll fight my struggles, but I'm not going to sanctify them by subverting the word of God. Okay? I think that's important, and that's what is going on. Now, that's what's going on. The effort to force the church to receive into its fellowship, and if you understand, that's where we started. The effort to force the church to receive into its fellowship those who are actively and impenitently engaged in homosexual conduct, that effort is only accelerating. It's not slowing down. It's accelerating. In the opening class, I quoted the following statement from a 2014 book written and published a little less than a year ago by Albert Moeller. Moeller is the president of Southern Baptist Theological Seminary. And Moeller said, evangelical Christians in the United States now face an inevitable moment of decision. While Christians in other movements and in other nations face similar questions, the question of homosexuality now presents evangelicals in the United States with a decision that cannot be avoided. Within a very short time, we will know where everyone stands on this question. There will be no place left to hide, no place to hide, and there will be no way to remain silent. To be silent will answer the question. Just a month ago, January 10th and 11th of 2015, some 1,500 people gathered in Portland, Oregon for the annual gathering of, quote, LGBTQ Christians, end quote. Lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, queer Christians. Sponsored by the Gay Christian Network. And among the attendees at that gathering was at least one group that is dedicated. Its mission is to convince evangelical churches, those holding to the authority of Scripture, at least one group there, its mission is to convince evangelical churches that they must change their view that homosexual conduct is sinful. Now, do you not know that they are using the very same tactics and things they use to sweep the culture? And they are now targeting the church because they cannot have that voice there. And so what are they doing? From the inside, we now go and say, oh, no, you've just misunderstood. You see this. That's why I'm doing this. You see, this is what is going on. That's January 10th and 11th. January 15th, 2015, Time Magazine, one of the many media allies of the homosexual movement, ran a feature-length article titled How Evangelicals Are Changing Their Minds on Gay Marriage. Just over a week ago, January 30th, Time Magazine runs a follow-up piece about Nashville, Tennessee's Grace Point Community Church, which they celebrated for becoming, quote, one of the first evangelical megachurches in the country to openly stand for full equality and inclusion of the LGBTQ community. You see, this is a great thing. Do you see the cultural forces that are at work to paint you as a moron, a hater, a bigot? You see that? And people don't like that. So we, what do? We'll shrink back, be quiet, leave the playing field to all the pro-homosexual voices. We'll just be quiet. We won't say, no, the Bible says that's wrong. You can't say that. What are you? No. You know, Joe Jones over here, he says it's not. We're after what God says. We're after what God says. Now, the great irony is that this campaign that is going on to subvert and twist the Bible, it's being conducted under the banner of love. Now, you talk about irony. It's being conducted under the banner of love, but love does not rationalize or encourage behavior that is detrimental to another's welfare. You recall 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9, right? Paul says men who engage in homosexual conduct will not inherit the kingdom of God. It doesn't get more detrimental than that. It doesn't get more detrimental than that. Love does not rationalize and encourage behavior that is detrimental to another's welfare. Rather, love tells a person the truth that he or she needs to hear, whether the person wants to hear it or not. Let me read you a quote from a man named Herbert Farmer. This is from his book published in 1938 called The Healing Cross. And Farmer says, "It is clear, even from our poor and thin experience, that love meets its most searching test when it is faced with the necessity of deeply estranging the one loved in order to bless him. And the more the love is pure and intense, the severer the test is, the more fierce the temptation to keep friendship at the cost of truth. When love is crying out for fellowship, it is the hardest thing in the world deliberately to pursue a course which you know will, for the time being, destroy it. Yet sometimes it is necessary. For a love which is not loyal to the truth, which is not rooted and grounded in the ultimate reality of things, is a perverted and horribly insecure thing. You are not doing people any favors by lying to them and telling them that's okay. That's okay. You just keep doing, oh no, God's fine with that. God's fine with that. In fact, what you're doing is extremely selfish. It is selfish because what you're doing is, I don't want him to think less of me. Is that the attitude of Christians? Aren't we willing to suffer abuse and scorn to bless people? I hope so. Seems to me that's what Jesus did. Now the church must patiently and lovingly call all sinners to repentance. All sinners to repentance. But it need not be blind to the fact that those trapped in one particular sin are trying to salve their consciences by misrepresenting God and forcing that false teaching into the church. That reality of people trying to misrepresent God and force that teaching into the church demands a certain emphasis on homosexual conduct in the teaching ministry of the church. Anything less would be pastoral malpractice. We're in a situation where the world and people are saying, we're going to convert the Bible believers into believing what God says is an abomination, that it's fine with him. Well, in that situation, the church needs to be aware of that. Well, you can't say, well, look, why don't you talk about gluttony? Why don't you talk about this? Talk about that. I'll call all sinners to repentance. But I won't be blind to the reality that we're in a social context where somebody's trying to push a particular false teaching into the church. I heard that. I'm almost through. Okay, this doesn't imply, it doesn't imply that one is accepting of other sins. It says only that one will not be misdirected from a clear and present spiritual danger. You see, this is what I've been trying to do. And my honest prayer is that these lessons will be a benefit to God's people. Thank you.